Bingo, 1 o'clock rock. Must be Wednesday. David Louie, former Attorney General, State of Hawaii. Wow, and a friend of mine. David, so nice of you to come down.
Jay, thank you.
Let's call this Life in the Law and Recherche des Temps Perdus. You know, remembering the good old days, so to say.
Okay, well, pardon my French, but I don't speak.
Okay, well, then we use a lot of it.
Okay.
So, you know, you had 4 years of Attorney General. You know, not a whole lot of people have that benefit. You got to see the inside of the government. You got to learn about everything that went on. You got to learn about the political process of the state, you know. It only takes a little while, but by the time you have 4 years, you really got it. I know that. How do you feel about it?
It was great. I had a wonderful time. Best job of my life.
Yeah.
Bill Clinton is rumored to have said best job he's ever had. Because he served as Attorney General for the state of Arkansas before he became governor. And what he said was, you wake up in the morning when you're Attorney General and you open up the paper and you say, who are we going to give hell to today? And when you're governor, you wake up in the morning and you open up the paper and you say, who's giving us hell today? And, you know, as Attorney General, the great thing about the job was you get to do what you think is right. And when people get mad at you, you go, blame it on the Constitution.
Not me.
Yeah. So it was a fabulous job. Had a great supporting cast. The people over at the Department of the Attorney General, the attorneys, the staff, everybody over there. Terrific
group of
people.
Hundreds of people, yeah.
185 attorneys, 750 total people, $70 million budget.
Wow.
It's a great organization, though, that helps move the state forward,
yeah.
Legally.
Got to have it.
Gotta have
it. Absolutely gotta have it.
Gotta have it, and you know, they don't pay them enough. It was in the paper that they're trying to get a raise. I tried to talk to the legislators to give more money. Doug Chin, my successor, is up there again trying to do it, and it may be getting some traction. It's difficult, but they underpay the attorneys general, the deputy attorneys general up there, and they should be paid more. They're terrific, dedicated public servants.
You know, I served on the High-Tech Development Corporation for a while. And there was a little ceremony in the legal administration where Steve Levinson got up and he said, I want you to remember one thing. It's the bug that bites you, the bug of community service, of government service. Once it bites you, you can never get away. What about you, David? Are you finished? Are you finished?
No, I'm not finished. I had a great time. I did community service before I became the Attorney General. I was the state bar president. I got to meet tons of people there. I served as the chair of the Aloha Tower Development Corporation for the state of Hawaii for 7 years or so. And I've worked on a number of other projects. So it's been a year now since I left the Attorney General's office, and I'm still just kind of in a transitional phase, trying to figure out what's next.
You're practicing with the Kobayashi firm.
Correct.
Yeah.
The Kobayashi firm was very gracious to extend an invitation to me, and I'm doing litigation, commercial litigation, some governmental relations work, and some other things. The firm is one of the larger firms in town, so it's a full-service firm that
Successful
has
firm.
A lot of capacity,
yeah.
And that's good.
You know, the thing about it is that it doesn't happen all the time. I guess it happened in Doug Chin's case, but it doesn't happen all the time when you get a practicing lawyer coming into Attorney General job. Frequently it's from somewhere else, especially a litigator lawyer coming in. And you know, you are a clear and clean litigator. You know how to address problems. You know how to speak your mind. And that's got to be a huge benefit in that office. Do you think it is?
Absolutely. I think it, you don't have any clue going in what the job is all about. Before I took the job, after it had been offered, I spoke to a couple of prior attorneys general. They all said, oh, take it, absolutely take it. But it's a hard job to describe. It's so broad. There's so many varied facets to it. There are so many different things you have to do, so many constituencies that you have to deal with. But it was a great job. I spoke to Doug Chin when he was considering taking it, and I told him, take it in a heartbeat.
Yeah.
Best job you'll ever have.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
hands down, best job I ever had.
Yeah. So would you say that in the crucible of that 4 years that you changed, you grew in some way? And if so, how?
Interesting question. Absolutely grew. I mean, having been a litigator and having tried cases and taken cases to a jury before and spoken to judges and argued lots of cases, I had a lot of experience. But the experience of leading the department, of helping to lead the state, of working closely with Governor Neil Abercrombie and with the cabinet officers was tremendous. Also working with the legislature was tremendous. So it was, you know, every day you'd wake up and there would be something new. It was always never a dull moment. You'd have lots of things to do. And so it was fascinating in that regard, and you always grow by having new experiences.
Yeah. You know, another French phrase comes to mind.
Okay.
I'm sorry about this. This is, you know, denominates our discussion here. Plus ça change, plus le même. It's true, isn't it? You know, you wake up every morning and it's new things, but then they're repetition of old things, or they're carry forward of old things. And, you know, it's always changing, swirling all around you. You're in the middle, you're in the hot seat, but it's kind of the same in a way.
A lot of things are similar, but a lot of things were different too. And you have new players coming in, new people, new ideas.
Yeah.
So it was really a tremendous experience.
Yeah, and all the people out there. Well, you know, I think it's an invaluable experience to work for government. Even my stint at the High Tech Development Corp, you know, taught me so much about DBED and how the way DBED, you know, talks to other agencies, talks to the fifth floor, talks to the legislature. I mean, it's an art form. And I wonder if you've ever developed a sense of how this state and this job and this kind of government, the way, you know, sort of the culture pattern of this government compares with other state governments in other places.
You know, that's a good question. I don't know how well or not well other governments function at the state level. I think ours does a decent job. Could it be better? Of course, it could always be better. One of the problems of democracies is that they're messy. You know, it's not the same as having a dictator say, this is the direction we're going, and everybody falls into line, or having a totalitarian or authoritarian society, which a number of countries have, okay? But it's much better because you get the consent of the governed, and you get the people going along, because after all, if you want to blame somebody and you point your finger at them, well, you're pointing three back at yourself. Because you elected these people. And so that's our check and balance for that. But I think our system works reasonably well. There are lots of checks and balances. Some people think that there are too many checks and balances and that it prevents us from getting things done.
I want to explore that with you, by the way. You know, the reference that David made to, you know, messy, and democracy is messy, is really a reference to the Tocqueville, who was another French guy. And I can't remember the French word he used, but democracy is definitely messy.
It's messy. Well, you've got a lot of people with a lot of different interests.
Yeah.
You know, I used to say that being AG was like being in a sumo wrestling match. Because what you had with government, and that's what democracy is you got a bunch of half-naked interests in there pushing and shoving and trying to knock the other guy
totally
out of the ring.
Totally self-interested. And, you know, speaking high phrase, but actually self-interested, and you have to figure out who's who.
Yeah. You know, and you have the dedicated public servants there, both the, you know, government executive officials and legislators, and they're trying to do the right thing. Everybody's trying, I think, to do the right thing.
But as a culture point, you know, Hawaii's got a rep, right? Got a rep for anti-business. It's got a rep. Some of that happened on your watch. Maybe no. I don't think anything
not
like that
too
happened
much.
On your
not
watch.
Not much anti. We were trying to climb out of the hole.
The super ferry issue.
The recession.
That was before
the super
your
ferry
time.
Was before my time.
Yeah. But
DMT was after my time.
Yes, perfect. Skate right through the middle.
Yeah.
But you know, it strikes me that Hawaii's got a rep not only for, you know, being anti-business, but being layered bureaucracy, and then it takes a long time. Now that's, you know, defensible in terms of transparency and dealing with the public and hearing everyone out. But I wonder. I hadn't thought of it when I asked the question at first, but I wonder whether we have too much of that, whether we're average, whether we're below average. How do we compare against other states? Because it can be, I'm sure you will agree, a problem sometimes.
I think we have as much bureaucracy as any state in the nation. Could we have less? I think we could. It's an issue. The trouble is somebody is always thinking of a problem that occurred, and they're trying to solve that problem by layering on some solutions that don't always work to deal with the next problem that's coming up.
Yeah.
And doesn't always work because if you want to be consistent, which many people want, if you want consistency, then, okay, we're going to treat everybody the same. So everybody has to jump through that hoop, regardless of whether it makes any sense or not. And so, yes, having a dictatorship or a modified authoritarian kind of a thing, you're going to get things done a lot faster, but you're going to break a lot of eggs. You're going to have a lot of people unhappy, and you're going to have a lot of people upset because they weren't listened to, or at least heard, and they didn't get a chance to register their viewpoint. I read a fascinating book called The Power Broker about a guy named Robert Moses, who held sway in New York.
He built
all these freeways
system,
and parks, but he ran roughshod over just tons of well-meaning people, and he didn't always make great decisions either. So a very interesting fellow.
Yeah.
We don't have that here. Could we use less bureaucracy? I believe so.
Yeah.
I believe so, and I'd like to see it streamlined. I think it'd be great.
Yeah. Now, what about transparency? I mean, there's a tension, obviously, between the bureaucracy and, or rather, the authoritarian approach, and the layered, you know, bureaucracy and transparency. Do you think that we have achieved, you know, an appropriate goal in transparency? Are we fair-minded public? You know, do we listen to the public? Is our government transparent enough for your taste?
I think the government is quite transparent, and it's an interesting dynamic. One of the things, and this is Robert Moses' book, when that guy was young, he was a reformer, and he wanted great transparency, he wanted everything disclosed and everything like that. When he actually came into power, he said, I don't want any of that, because transparency is just allowing people to figure out what I'm doing and slowing me down. And so many times the transparency aspect just becomes an excuse for somebody to slow down something and to delay and stall and prevent. And, you know, there are goals, and some of the goals of people to stop things that are happening is just to delay and hope that the other side will lose its resolve. And that's an unfortunate thing because it adds cost, it adds bureaucracy, it adds time. And I'm not sure we have that luxury in this world anymore.
Yeah, and it's a judgment call, isn't it? I mean, for a guy in a position of attorney general, to see somebody who says, I'm going to try to stop that project no matter what. You know, you can rule against me, but I'm like the Hydra. I keep coming back for more, I'm going to appeal it, I'm going to go to the streets, and then I'm going to, whatever I do, I'm going to keep on going. There's a social hyphen government compact involved, isn't there, where we all agree that at a certain point you stop already and you reflect, you know, you respect, you know, the determination of the government, the determination of the institutions. But these days, it seems to me, not only in Hawaii but elsewhere, that people never stop. They keep on trucking no matter what. They're determined to stop a project. They go right to the top, and then they fight some more.
And that happens, and you have to give the devil their due. People are determined, and they believe in their causes, and they believe in their point of view. But the idea of allowing somebody to go forward now after we've taken a vote and lost, that idea has been lost. Now it's like, I'll appeal, and then I'll appeal, and I'll appeal, and I'll keep appealing.
Yeah.
There's an old watchword of never give up. Well, some people never give up.
Yeah. Well, that seems to be a culture point, not only here but elsewhere, that I think, I'd be interested in your thought about it. This is, on a large scale, on a national scale, this does not work well because it gets in the way of the rule of the majority, if you will.
I think that's absolutely true. And, you just have, unfortunately, I mean, I, I believe in democracy, and I believe in the government institutions we have, and I think they work reasonably well. But they can be subverted, and they can be stymied, and you can get no progress. I mean, I'm just amazed that we get anything out of the U.S. Congress these days. And things like, these are crying problems. Infrastructure, bridges, highways, roads, and things like that. And those things can't, you can't get the money for them. Now, luckily, the Congress finally came together after about 4 years and finally did something. Is it enough? I'm not sure. But they need to do a lot more.
Yeah, and we need to do a break.
And you know, that
there
would
are
be
priorities.
Good.
That's David Louie, former Attorney General of the State of Hawaii. Wow, here on Life and the Law. And we're talking about Ray Sharsta, Tom Perdue as Attorney General. We'll be right back, you'll see.
Aloha, my name is Kawi Lucas. I am the host of Hawaii is My Mainland here every Friday on Think Tech Hawaii at 3 p.m. I invite people who are doing interesting and inspiring things in our community to help us keep it local and keep it real. Tune in any Friday, 3 p.m. and also available on our YouTube channel and my blog, kawilucas.com. Hawaii is my mainland. Aloha.
Hi, aloha. My name is Chris Leatham, and I have host a show called The Economy and You. The show plays every Wednesday at noon. And on my show, I bring on guests who are interested or working in the technology space. And so I'd like you to come and watch the show and learn with me about all the sort of exciting things that we're doing in Hawaii to build and grow our economy ecosystem. So I'd like to say aloha, and I look forward to seeing you on the show. Thank you.
Oh, thanks.
And there were some people there that wanted you.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay, we're back. We're live. We're here. I'm Jay Fidel. That's David Louie, former Attorney General of the State of Hawaii. We're talking, we're sort of revisiting his time in office during the Abercrombie administration. And we have a tweet we will play with a little bit, and the tweet is about TMT. What are the implications of the state's reaction to TMT? This is a politically sensitive issue. Here you are, you know, 1 year off a very politically sensitive job. You know, what's your inclination about this issue?
You know, the TMT decision is a hugely controversial decision. So you have to look at a couple of things. One, I was a firm believer as the Attorney General that matters involving Native Hawaiian issues many times needed to go to the Supreme Court. Just because, and not because of we're never going to give up, we always want to keep appealing. That's not the reason. The reason was is that because these things are very contentious and potentially very contentious, it's really important to have the state Supreme Court weigh in and say this, you know, something. Because if you give up down at the lower level, somebody's always unhappy or there's always criticism of that. So anyway, the TMT decision went up to the state Supreme Court. And on one level, you have the political dimension, which is, you know, a lot of people are very opposed to the TMT project on grounds that they consider the mountain sacred, that they consider it an affront to Native Hawaiian culture, and that they consider it an affront to the Native Hawaiian host community here. On the other hand, you have a lot of people, including Native Hawaiians, who want to move science forward, who believe that it is being done in a respectful manner, that it will bring jobs here, that it will be good for the state, and that it will bring a lot of things together. So you have these opposing political views. And with that backdrop, then you have the Supreme Court weighing in on the issues of legality. And what the Supreme Court said was that they, meaning the DLNR, and that they were advised by some of the deputy attorneys general, and that they needed to go back and do the process over because they hadn't given appropriate due process by having the DLNR, the Board of Land and Natural Resources, made a decision and then had a contested case instead of having a contested case first and a decision later. My view as Attorney General has always been that we have to be careful before we throw too many judicial processes into every facet of life that exists in government. Because what's amazing is that government actually works by the cooperation and service of hundreds of volunteers, hundreds of lay people who are not lawyers. And if you're going to impose legal procedures on them to do every little thing, then I guess we're going to have all lawyers there, which is good for the lawyers, but not necessarily good for the lay people. So I have always been a firm believer in making sure that we have enough procedures to guarantee due process, but that we do not do too much. Now, some people agree, some people disagree with the Supreme Court decision. It was a 5-0 decision that they felt that they should have more due process. And people will argue about that. So what gets lost sometimes is you have this political movement and people cheer the decision because it reached a political result that they either liked, or people hate it because it reached a political decision they didn't like. But the legal issue as to more due process or not is a lawyer-like thing that will affect how
cases later.
Yes,
yeah.
How future cases get heard. No,
I agree with everything you said. And it reminds me of your confirmation hearing way back when, 4 or 5 years ago, where, you know, God, your answers were good. I kept thinking, could I ever think of an answer like that? Could I ever handle this hearing that way? You're real good on your feet. No kidding, David.
Well, thank you. That's very nice of you to say. The interesting thing about the confirmation process is that my hearing occurred relatively late in the legislative session, and I had been on the job for months before my confirmation hearing
occurred. That's a
benefit. It's actually a benefit. Yeah. If you had a person who hasn't been in government and you put them up for a confirmation hearing right like that, most of the time, they might have a deer in the headlights look and say, I don't know. Let me say, I don't know. And I think I don't know.
Dangerous.
Because, I mean, government, there are so many inside issues. You know, some people think that government is a black box. It's not really a black box. There's a certain logic to it. I mean, you start with the statutes, you look at the rules, you look at the people, you look at what people are trying to do, and there are procedures. Sometimes it seems, if you don't know those rules, if you don't know the statutes and the procedures, then it seems like a black box.
Overwhelming, yeah.
Okay, but it really is not. It has an internal logic to it, and people are trying to do the right thing.
Well, the interesting thing is the role of the Attorney General, who is a state officer, vis-a-vis all these other agencies, departments, what have you, and the governor and the legislature. This is an interesting triangulation. I mean, coming in, it's not easy to understand exactly how that works. You're the kind of the hub of the legal wheel, so to speak, and you got to deal with them all. And, oh, the Supreme Court, did I mention that? The Supreme Court, you have a certain relationship, a role with all of these government agencies, and you've got to retain a certain independence.
Yes, and I mean, the Attorney General is the chief law enforcement officer of the state, both criminally and civilly. Most of the criminal things are delegated to the county prosecutors, and that's fine. So I'd say 90% of the job was actually civil, and advising all of these different clients, the legislators, the governor, sometimes even the courts, if they got sued or claims were made or something like that, and every employee in every agency. The good thing, the thing I used to like to tell the deputy attorneys general was, the good thing is that our clients could not fire us. The bad thing was sometimes we could not fire them either. And so we had to find a way to work together and to move the thing
forward. This means negotiation.
Yes. And it means you don't always get what you want.
Suppose you're the attorney general and you find that black is black, white is white, and some fellow out there, some department head says, you know, David, I don't agree with you.
And that would happen sometimes.
Yeah.
And so then you figure out, well, what's the tiebreaker? And the tiebreaker is in the statute, which says the attorney general gets to decide on litigation. So for litigation matters, the attorney general gets to make the decision. And that's by statute.
Yeah.
And so if I mean, there was a consultation thing. I always had to consult with the governor above certain levels if we were going to pay money or do something else. Yeah. But ultimately, the decision was mine. And that's the way, you know, the statutes are written that way. Not every state has that statute. Not every state has that procedure. You always want a tiebreaker. Because at the end of the day, you want to talk, you want to try and persuade, but at the end of the day, somebody needs to make a decision. Because if you don't have somebody making a decision, then you just go round and around. If you're waiting for full consensus, where people are diametrically opposed, you will only be stymied and you'll never get anywhere.
I hope you're taking notes on this. This is really important, very sophisticated stuff. But moving on, though, your favorite issues. What kind of issues came up that you think of now? What kind of issues sort of had an effect on your legal thinking, your life, and the state, for that matter?
Well, I think one of the signature issues that we were able to pass during Governor Abercrombie's term was same-sex marriage. And I had an interesting history with that, because the first way it came up was it came up and there was a challenge that was filed to the existing law, which prohibited same-sex marriage. And so we had to decide what to do with that. And the plaintiffs, who was this lesbian couple who filed suit, had named both the governor and the director of health. And so we did, because there was, actually it was controversial, and we people had, you know, it was a very political kind of a thing. So we took actually both sides of the issue. I had one team of attorneys general.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Who represented the governor. Yeah. And we had another team of deputy attorneys general who represented the legislature and defended the law.
Okay, is there a, forgive this expression, but was there a Chinese wall?
Yes. Exactly.
You better tell them what that means.
Yes, well, some people say that the Great Wall of China is this divide, keeps things on the left or on the right or whatever, and never the twain shall meet. Some people don't like that description anyway.
But between us, it's
that.
Okay.
Yes. But the interesting thing is that there is actually a decision in Hawaii. The Hawaii Supreme Court has said that although most lawyers, and actually every other lawyer but the Attorney General's office, in the state of Hawaii can only represent one side or another of a particular issue or dispute, the Attorney General is in a unique position because we represent the whole government. And so there can be times when, as long as we have a wall and we keep the team separate and they don't try and talk behind their backs it's all above board, we could actually represent both sides. So there we represented Governor Abercrombie saying, no, this law is wrong, it should go. And we represented the state and the legislature saying, no, this law was duly passed and it is the law of the land. Now, the legislature, in cooperation with Governor Abercrombie, as the dominoes were falling and the U.S. Supreme Court was ruling and the climate in the country was changing, the legislature passed same-sex marriage. I went up. I was very happy to testify in favor of same-sex marriage. I personally felt that was the right way to go, but I was very, very happy, and I thought it was, you know, it was a moment in history when things changed.
Indeed.
It was really a tremendous moment. I thought a tremendous thing. The legislature went through hell because it was so controversial.
Oh, people in the courtyard there in the legislature?
Absolutely.
Oh, every day?
But, I mean, that's democracy, and it's messy. Yeah. And they listened, and then they passed the law. Yeah. And I was very pleased that I was there when the governor signed it. I was there when it all went through. And then there was a challenge in the courts, and I had the privilege and the honor of going in and defending the law against the challenge in the court.
The state Supreme Court.
In the state, not in the lower court, and the state Supreme Court decision came after I left. Just the final decision at the appellate level came after I had left.
Already pretty established, though.
Yes, and another deputy attorney general argued it in front of the state Supreme Court. Yeah. But I was very, very proud of that. I was very proud to be associated with that. Another thing that I was very proud to be associated with, working with Governor Abercrombie, was the settlement of Native Hawaiian claims that were 30 years old that OHA had brought against the state for past due amounts for ceded lands, past due rents.
Yeah.
So there was a gigantic claim. They were claiming around $600 million of additional monies, I think somewhere $400 to $600 million. Depends on who's counting and how they're counting.
This is all emerges out of the 78 Constitutional Convention.
Yes, Yes, that's correct. And the decision that OHA would get a certain amount of the revenues from the ceded lands, which were the government lands that had been taken from the Crown, given to the federal government, and then brought back and given to the state at admission. And so we were able to sit down with OHA. There had been attempts previously to get a settlement through the legislature. The legislature had not been willing to do that under Governor Lingle for whatever reason. And I was able to sit down with the attorneys for OHA, and we said, look, let's try it this way, and let's do this. We gave $200 million approximately, plus or minus, of land in Kaka'ako-Makai, prime land, very valuable land. Because some of the objections previously had been they didn't want, some Hawaiians, Native Hawaiians, did not want land off in the hinterlands or land that they considered to be inferior. There was always going to be a question about accounting and how much is this land worth, and are we going to have a penny here or a penny there or do some things. We agreed, look, we're going to give you approximately $200 million worth of land, and here are the parcels we'll give you. And, you know, the legislature got on board with that, OHA got on board with that, and we passed that. And I think it was the right thing to do.
It was notable.
And I was very happy to resolve those claims. They hadn't been resolved for 30 years.
Yeah, yeah.
Another thing we did.
Wait, before you do that,
go ahead.
Take another break.
That's a good idea.
Okay, thank you, David. David Louie, former Attorney General of the State of Hawaii, here on Life in the Law. We're talking about recherche de temps perdu. We'll be right back.
Aloha, I'm Rachel Juergen with Aging with Grace. Please join us every Tuesday on thinktech.com.
Hello, I'm Stephen Katz, and I'm the host of Shrink Wrap, which comes to you live every Tuesday at 3 p.m. on thinktechhawaii.com, and then it's repeated again whenever you want if you go to the website. On our show, we will be talking to all different kinds of therapists, psychologists, psychoanalysts, psychiatrists, people who talk about the mind, the brain, and about different ways to find happiness. I myself am a marriage and family therapist in practice here in Hawaii, and I hope you will join us because I've got a lot to learn, you've got a lot to learn, and it's a great ride. Thanks a lot. See you soon.
Okay, we're back. We're live. We're here with David Louie. We're talking about his time as Attorney General during the Abercrombie administration. And we just got finished, looking back to the deal with OHA. But I remember, there was this statute. I think it still exists, that does not permit condominium development, beyond a certain height restriction in Kaka'ako-Makai.
Yes.
How did that affect the valuation that you ultimately used to reach the settlement?
It did affect the valuation, and it was taken into account by the appraisers in the values that they gave us was there. And there were appraisers from OHA that took that into account as well. So, in fact, when we calculated the plus or minus $200 million, it was appraised as the land was under those restrictions.
Right. So and it would have been more
yes.
had those restrictions not applied.
Yes. So that if the height limits are raised in Kaka'ako-Makai, as some have urged, that would make the land more valuable. But we did not shortchange OHA.
Right.
We gave them full value based upon the restrictions that existed.
Right. Really interesting. Interesting yes. deal. Interesting time you had. I suppose the other thing I would ask about is the Turtle Bay deal. That was a very hot item. That was on the paper all the time. You went through the gauntlet on that one, too.
We did. With Governor Abercrombie, we were able to get that done, and working with the Turtle Bay people, there were a lot of moving parts on that. We were able to get the legislature to approve putting aside funds, $40 million, to buy... conservation easement so that 665 acres of pristine land up at Covella Bay, Turtle Bay, would remain in conservation, would not be developed into high-rise condominiums or even developed as condominiums at all. We got it through, and I was very, very happy. The subsequent year, this past year, because of the means of financing that had been push through. I think the administration that was Governor Ige took a look at it and thought that there was a better way to do the financing, and so they revised the deal somewhat. But they have finally inked it, and it's essentially the same deal that we had negotiated. But I mean, there are some changes and some tweaks, the good thing is we got the conservation easement. I'm very proud of that.
You know, but it does point out, I think really everything on your watch points out that you really need to have a business lawyer, a practicing lawyer in that job, because there's a lot of business going on. The state is a business player in so many deals, and you have to be prepared for that. You have to be prepared for the negotiating table, to make litigation choices, to know the status of humanity, to know the human condition.
All of those things are important. I was fortunate enough to have enough of a background in litigation and in negotiation and business matters and just a wide variety of things that I felt that I was able to step up and take my swings at the plate.
Yeah, because we're referring back to the whole thing about, you know, protest and people who never give up. Well, you can get them to give up if you can cut a deal with them.
Yep.
And so if you have the skills to cut the deal, then you're shortcutting a process that might take years and years and be so demoralizing to everybody. So if you're a business lawyer, you have a place as Attorney General for sure.
And I think that's a good thing.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's talk about marijuana. Would that come up on your watch?
What came up, every year in the past, the idea of dispensaries has come up. And recreational marijuana sometimes comes up, hemp has come up, and things like that. When I first came into office, I met with the law enforcement community. We had the Law Enforcement Coalition, which was the police chiefs and all of the prosecutors. And they, law enforcement has been very concerned about widening the scope of medical marijuana. I think law enforcement, some people don't agree with even with medical marijuana, but I think the general consensus was that since we had passed medical marijuana and since there have been proven studies showing the benefits of medical marijuana, that people were okay with that. What law enforcement has always been concerned about is recreational marijuana and whether or not that is detrimental to the community by having kids or even young adults, or even older adults, driving under the influence, operating heavy machinery under the influence, doing something like that. And so our legislature last year passed medical marijuana. That was after my time. But now I am, in my current role as a private attorney, helping some clients who are interested in applying for dispensary licenses and being one of the 8 lucky winners to help move medical marijuana forward in the state. So it's an interesting transition for me. My view has been not that I have forsaken my law enforcement roots and what I worked on and stood for, because we want to keep out criminal elements. We want to make sure it's done right. We want it transparent. We want to make sure that security is tight, and we want it strictly for medical purposes.
Yeah, and if you decriminalize something, you're pouring light on it. You're opening it up. You're making it more transparent.
And that's true. And I think, back a long time ago, possession of one or two marijuana cigarettes was a misdemeanor. And I think our society has just changed. The climate is that the community doesn't worry about it as much. They haven't felt, you saw all of those old movies of, reefer madness, where one puff on a marijuana cigarette would lead to a life of ruin. And that just hasn't been the case.
No. And for that reason, recreational marijuana remains a possibility, but it seems to me that the whole medical marijuana statute is kind of an experiment. It's a laboratory on that road, which is not necessarily assured, but we can find out pretty much how it works now.
Yeah, I think that's true. And I think, Hawaii is socially conservative.
Yeah.
We haven't been on the forefront of social issues all the time. People here want to see how things go. And we're going to watch, I think, what's going on in Colorado, what's going on in Washington and California and Oregon and some of these other states that have been much more liberal in terms of allowing recreational marijuana and seeing, okay, well, how bad is it? What happens? What are the downsides of that?
How can we fix that?
Yeah.
How can we control it? How can we make it work? Well, that's the whole thing, and I submit that your time, just as your time as a litigator beforehand in a private law firm prepared you for being, the Attorney General of the State, your time as Attorney General of the State prepares you now, to fully appreciate the issues. I mean, right now, I'm sure you read the newspaper differently than you did before.
No, I still read it right side up.
Oh, okay.
And left to right. My time in government was hugely valuable. Like I said, best job I ever had. The other great thing was I got to meet a lot of national attorneys general, other states' attorneys general, who and people who are up and coming on the national bench, politically, both Republicans and Democrats. And there are some tremendously bright, committed, intelligent people. So I felt really, really good about working with them and working with them on issues and trying to move our country forward.
Yeah. Well, I think this is a time with so many issues, so many changes, that requires a lot of wisdom, especially in the Office of Attorney General. You're the backstop on so many things. You know, if it's worked out beforehand, it doesn't get to the Supreme Court.
Right. That's true.
And business happens.
That's true.
So what's your advice to Doug Chen? What's your advice to...
Oh, that's a dangerous question.
Sorry. You can couch your answer any way you like.
No, I think Doug Chen's doing a terrific job. He's measured, he's steady, he's personable, he's intelligent, and he has good analytical skills. All of the comments I've heard about his performance are very good.
Yeah.
So I'm sure he's going to do fine. I stay in touch with him, and we chat here and there, and as far as I can tell, he's doing a great job.
David Louie, a living proof of the fact that you can, be a lawyer, be an attorney general, be a lawyer again, and all the way through that, be a nice guy, all the way through, living proof. David Louie, Attorney General, former Attorney General of the State of Hawaii. Thank you so much for coming down.
Thank you, Jay. Appreciate it.
Aloha.
Aloha.
Now.